لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين، سيدي وحبيبي ونور قلبي وثمرة فؤادي أبي القاسم محمد.
اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد
وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين الهاديين المظلومين الذين أذهب الله عنهم الرجس وطهرهم تطهيرا.
اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد.
قال الله العلي العظيم في كتابه الكريم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم: وضرب الله مثلا للذين آمنوا امرأة فرعون إذ قالت رب ابن لي عندك بيتا في الجنة ونجني من فرعون وعمله ونجني من القوم الظالمين. ومريم ابنة عمران التي أحسنت فرجها فنفخنا فيها من روحنا وصدقت بكلمات ربها وكتبه وكانت من القانتين. صدق الله العلي العظيم.
اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد.
First I would like to offer my condolences to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
And to Ahlul Bayt alayhim assalam in general, and especially our 12 Imam, Imam Sahib al-Asr wa al-Zaman.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
And I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to help us to be the true followers of Zahra alayhi salam, and grant us the shafa'ah of Zahra on the Day of Judgment as well, insha'Allah. As we are commemorating the martyrdom of Zahra alayhi salam, we would like to touch a basis on these verses that we just read in Surah Al-Tahrim, the chapter of forbidden, verse 11 and 12, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about two of the four best women in Islam. As you know, in Islam, we believe that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose four best women. The first of those four is Zahra alayhi salam. The second is Khadija alayhi salam. The third is Maryam alayhi salam. And the fourth is Asiya bint Muzah. These are the four best women in Islam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about these two of them and these two ayahs that we just read in Surah Al-Tahrim. The first is the wife of Fir'aun, Asiya, and the other one is Maryam alayhi salam. Two of them, Asiya and ayah number 11, and in ayah number 12, Allah talks about Maryam alayhi salam. But tonight, I want to take you in different road, and that is to talk about these four women and then see who is the best among all the four. Because you know the custom of Allah, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, everything He creates, He chooses the best. And he said in the Quran, وَرَبُّكَ يَخْلُقْ وَيَخْتَارْ. Your Lord creates and He chooses the best. That's the custom of Allah. All of us, as you look at us as a human being, Allah created us and He chose certain individuals. We call them prophet. All right? And how many are they? 124,000. And among those 124,000, Allah made another choice also. He chose Some of them, we call them Ulul Azm. Right? Now, among those Ulul Azm, he chose one to be the best of all, and that is Habib al-Mustafa Muhammad.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
That is among human, right? Now you go among angels. Allah created all angels. But then he goes and picks some of them. Right? Now the best of all angels is Jibreel. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in the Quran that no angel is above Jibreel. And Allah talks that every angel have to listen to Jibreel. Muta'in thumma amin. Obeyed. They all are under the control of Jibreel. Then Allah chose some of them. We call them the angel of death, which we don't want to hear most of the time. When we hear Jibreel, we say alayhi salam, because he brings message. When we hear Malak al-Maut, silent, because he takes a life, right? But it's one of them. Another one Allah created among the angels, and he chose the angels who are known the bodyguards. Right? He called them Raqib and Atid. And their job is to write everything that we do. And Quran says about them, مَا يَلْفِظُ مِنْ قَوْلٍ إِلَّا لَدَيْهِ رَقِيبٌ. No word comes out of your mouth unless they record it. Right? And when you look in Arabic, when they said العتيد الفطن الذي لا تفوته حركة. عتيد means smart, who no movement happen without him notice. That is how fast it is. Right? That is one of the angels. Now, the bottom line is that Allah created all those angels and he pick and choose some of them. Now, not only angels. Even stones, Allah created stones, he picked some stones are better than the other stones.
MashaAllah.
You go to Kaaba, it's a stone. But it's not like any other stone in any part of the world. Then there's one stone inside it, it's called Hajarul Aswad. Hajar it's called. But that stone cannot be compared because it's chosen by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now you come to our days, we have 7 days a week. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose out of the 7 days, one night or one day is considered the best of all. And that is Friday. And that is how Allah chooses. For that matter, this is just an introduction to the point that I want to make. And that is Allah, when he creates in everything, he chooses the best. Now we know all these women, they are best. They are great, they are chosen by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but we want to find who is the best of all of them. Because you go to the Quran, Allah says all the prophet, they are people I choose. But then Allah tell the prophet in the Quran, Ya Rasulullah, listen careful. وَلَا تَكُنْ كَصَاحِبِ الْحُوتِ. Ya Rasulullah, don't be like Yunus. Because your level is higher than Yunus. And Surah Al-Baqarah says, تِلْكَ الرُّسُلْ فَضَّلْنَا بَعْضَهُمْ عَلَىٰ بَعْضٍ. Among the prophet, there are some of them are better than the others. Now the ayah we just read in Surah Al-Tahrim, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about the wife of Fir'aun. وَضَرَبَ اللَّهُ مَثَلًا. Allah said, we set up an example. But this example is not for just one group and not the other. Allah said, لِلَّذِينَ آمَنُوا. Here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to clarify one misconception, one misunderstanding in Islam, that some of us, we think a man supposed to be an example for all men and women, and not the other way around. Allah said that's wrong thinking. Allah said a woman can be example for men too. Where is it? Allah said in the Quran, and that is how much Islam have respected a woman. No religion have ever gave a woman the honor and dignity like Islam. And if you want to know, check what you call حقوق المرأة في الإسلام. That was written by one of the great scholars, Ayatollah Shahid Mutahhari. And that book, and see from the Quran and Hadith how much right Islam has given to a woman. And then go and check any other religion or any other civilization. how much they have given right to a woman. And then compare between the two, and then you realize how much Islam has given a woman the right that no human being ever can even imagine. And one of them is, Islam gave this responsibility. A man who is qualified can lead male and female. And a woman who is qualified can be example for male and female. And one of those women is Asiya. وَضَرَبَ اللَّهُ مَثَلًا لِلَّذِينَ آمَنُوا. Who are those? أَمْرَأَةَ فِرْعَوْنَ. Allah said, the wife of Fir'aun. And here was one lesson. You know, in Islam, relationship is not important to Allah. What matters to Allah is your own action towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because sometimes we think, my father is an alim. I am sayyid. I am this. But Islam said, if you don't follow the action of that alim, you will not go where the alim is going to go. If your father is a prophet, you don't follow the teaching of your father, you are not going to be with your father in the same level. And you can see that, and that's one of the teaching of Quran. Here Allah wants to tell us, it says, Imra'ata Fir'aun. Now look, they are husband and wife, but they went separate ways, even though they have a relationship. Right? And that's one of the teaching of Islam. You come to Islam, there are people who relate to each other. Like Nuh alayhi salam, he and his son, a father is an ulul azm. But the son was not obedient. In the Quran, when Nuh alayhi salam was talking to Allah, Rabbi inna abni min ahli wa inna wa'daka al-haq. And I believe your promise is truth. You know what Allah told Nuh? He said, Ya Nuh, innahu laysa min ahli. No, he's not part of your family. It's not about blood relationship, it's about action. And Allah says, إِنَّهُ عَمَلٌ غَيْرُ صَالِحٌ. Your son, he didn't do. So he's not going to be with you. And Allah said to Noah, فَلَا تُخَاطِبْنِي فِي الَّذِينَ غَرِبُوا. Don't even speak to me. Allah is telling Noah, don't even speak to me about those who were drawn in that. That is one, right? So in Islam, a man who is a bad man, he was married to a good woman. If he doesn't do a good deed like a woman, Allah said they are going to go different separate way. And here Asiya and Fir'aun is one example. Good woman, a bad husband. Let me give you another example. A good husband and a bad wife. And Quran mentioned too, in the same surah Al-Tahrim, Allah talks about two prophets who were married to bad women. One of them is Lut alayhi salam. Prophet Lut was a prophet, messenger, but his wife was not a good one. And they went separate ways. Husband and wife. Husband was good, the wife was bad, they separated. A father and a son. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't care how related to you, that you are to each other. And Allah said about Fir'aun, He said, وَضَرَبَ اللَّهُ مَثَلًا لِلَّذِينَ آمَنُوا إِمْرَأَةَ فِرْعَوْنَ. The wife of Fir'aun, she was not only a mu'mina, she was one of the best women Allah ever chose. And Allah said, إِذْ قَالَتْ رَبِّ ابْنِ لِي إِنْدَكَ بَيْتًا فِي الْجَنَّةِ. She asked Allah, Oh Lord, I ask you to build me a house next to you, إِنْدَكَ, next to you in heaven. Now let me tell you just a short story. How did he get to this point where she's asking Allah this? You know Asiya bint Muzahim? Some narration said she was a believer, but she was not revealing to her husband Fir'aun because he was a tyrant and oppressor. Until Allah told Musa alayhi salam to go and rescue Bani Israel. They came and they gave all the proof. Because when they walk in the castle of Fir'aun, and they told Fir'aun, we came to invite you to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Fir'aun says, وَمَا رَبُّكُمَا يَا مُوسَى. Who's your Lord that you're talking about? Musa alayhi salam said to him, رَبِّيَ الَّذِي أَعْطَى كُلَّ شَيْءٍ خَلْقَهُ ثُمَّ هَدَى. My Lord is the one who created everything and then guided it. Then Musa alayhi salam showed him his miracle. After the miracle, Fir'aun says, this man is a magician. He then invited all the soldiers, all the magicians to come. to prove Musa alayhi salam that he's not the best magician. And Quran said that Pharaoh, he called all the earth, he summoned every magician in Egypt to come against their will, and they came. And he told them, I want you to win this man. And look at them, Allahu Akbar. And they asked Pharaoh, أَإِنَّ لَنَا لَعَجْرًا إِن كُنَّا نَحْنُ الْغَالِبِينَ. Would we be rewarded if we win? See, Pharaoh was smart. He didn't tell them that I'll give you this amount of money. No. He said, إِنَّكُمْ لَمِنَ الْمُقَرَّبِينَ. The reward that you're getting, you're going to be closest people to me. I said, that's enough. It's a done deal. Then he came. As they were sitting, then they said to Musa alayhi salam, Elqi, start throwing your magic. Musa told them, no, you start. And they started throwing the magic. And the Quran tells us, وَجَاءُوا بِسِحْرٍ عَظِيمٍ. Quran is telling us, they brought a great magic. And here to understand, some people say there is no magic. No, there is. If somebody tells you there's no magic, Quran says there is magic. وَجَاءُوا بِسِحْرٍ عَظِيمٍ. But one thing the Quran tells you, it says a magician cannot become victorious upon a mu'min. That's impossible. وَلَا يُفْلِحُ السَّاحِرُ حَيْثُ أَتَى. If you're a mu'min, a magician cannot win you. That's what you have to understand. But there's magic. Right? And the Quran said, وَجَاءُوا بِسِحْرٍ عَظِيمٍ. They came with a great magic. Even Musa alayhi salam, ma'asum, he became scared. When he saw this magic, he became scared. And Quran told him, لا تخف إنك أنت الأعلى. Don't be scared. You are the winner. Because you have Allah with you. What happened? Musa alayhi salam, he threw the stick. And then Quran says, the stick started swallowing every single magic that was thrown under. And those magicians, they were smart. When they saw their magic and what Musa presented, they realized that what Musa presented is more than magic. It's beyond magic. So what happened? And the Quran says, فَأُلْقِيَ السَّحَرَةُ سَاجِدِينَ. They immediately threw everything and went to the sajda. Allahu Akbar. Right? Amazing. Here, look at the power of sajda. Now they went to sajda, by the time these people, before they came to contest with Musa alayhi salam, they were scared of Fir'aun. But look, after they went to that sajda and they came back, they were different people. Look at the power of sajda. They first came, they were scared of Fir'aun. Whatever he says, done. Now the same Fir'aun, after they did the sajda, they raised their head. Fir'aun started being threaten them. لَأُقَتَّعَنَّ عَيْدِيَكُمْ وَأَرْجُلَكُمْ مِنْ خِلَافٍ وَلَأُصَلِّبَنَّكُمْ. I'll cut your hands and legs and I'll hang you. I'll crucify you. Allahu Akbar. You know what they said? فَسْنَا مَا أَنْتَ صَانِ. Do whatever you want to do. We don't care. We found Allah and Allah is sufficient. That is what they said. Now, Asiya bint Muzahim, she was sitting and she was watching the whole thing next to her husband. And she said to her husband, Ya Fir'aun, what this Musa brought is not a magic. I don't believe it's a magic. Fir'aun said, be quiet. Right? Don't speak to me about what Fir'aun, what Musa alayhi salam is doing. She was quiet. Then she said the second time, the third time, Fir'aun said, be quiet. Then she said to Fir'aun, Ya Fir'aun, can I say something? He said, yes, go ahead. What do you want to say? Then she said, not only that what Musa alayhi salam presented is not a magic, but I'm here to declare to you, Fir'aun, that I believe that Musa is a messenger of Allah and there is no God but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And she is saying this to a man who all his life, he said he is the supreme Lord. Ana rabbukum al-a'la. That's what Quran used to say. Now his wife is telling him, no, not only I don't believe you are a God, no, I believe you are nothing, and Musa alayhi salam is the messenger of Allah. that Pharaoh became angry. And Pharaoh ordered that his wife Asiya should be punished. And you know Pharaoh, la'anatullah alayhi, when he takes a person, the way he punished them is that he has four pillars that he made. And what he does is he ties every person that he brings, they have to tie their hands towards the two pillars and the left with the other two pillars. And that's why Quran says in Surah Al-Fajr about Fir'aun. It says, وَفِرْعَوْنَ ذِلْ أَوْتَاد. Al-Awtad in Arabic is the plural of watad, and watad means pillar. And Allah used in Surah Al-Naba, it says, وَالْجِبَالَ أَوْتَادَ. We made the mountains that you see, they're the pillars of the earth. So Fir'aun used to make those pillars so he can punish. Then he asked his army, I want you to put my wife in the same one. Just because she disobeyed. They brought Asiya, they tied her up. Allahu Akbar. Now this is a lesson that I want us to take today from those women. Because today, we are just facing smallest examples, smallest tests in our time. But don't we try to run from Islam? Allah. Right? Some of us, because of small disrespect, I say, I want to take my hijab off. Some of us, because of somebody's disrespect, I want to change my name. I don't want anybody to know I'm a Muslim. Now listen to the people who live before you and I. And take this example. Asiya bint Muzahim, she is a first lady of that time. She has everything one can ever ask. But now she's leaving everything for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They brought her, they tied her up. Fir'aun came and told her, Asiya, this is your house, look. Everything you can think of is in that house. Every servant that you want is in there. Just denounce Musa and go back to your house. And she said, no. Allahu Akbar. He said, I don't want to. I found Allah and I'm not going back. Pharaoh look at her. I say, Asiya, look, this is the house that I built you. You live in this house for years. Everything is in this house is yours. Why are you willing to give up everything? While Pharaoh was talking to her, she turned towards Allah. And that is what the ayah is talking about. She said, Rabbi ibnili indaka baytan fil jannah. Fir'aun is proud of this house that was built on this world, right? He said, I don't want this house. I want better house. Which where? Which house? He said, Indaka baytan fil jannah. I want the house that you, Allah, built. And I want the house to be next to you. Allahu Akbar. Two requests at the same time. I want Jannah, but I want Jannah that is far away from you. No, close to you. And then she said, وَنَجِّنِي مِنْ فِرْعَوْنَ. Ya Allah, I ask you to rescue me from Fir'aun. And why did she ask this? Because Fir'aun, after he saw that his wife is not going to give up, so he made an order that they should bring a hot water and pour on her, and so that the skin can be burned so she can feel the pain. So she said to Allah, نَجِّنِي مِنْ فِرْعَوْنَ. Rescue me. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala immediately told the angel of death, go take your life before Fir'aun comes to punish you. And that is why she said, وَنَجِّنِي مِنْ فِرْعَوْنَ. Ya Allah, rescue me from Fir'aun. وَعَمَلِهِ and his action. وَنَجِّنِي مِنَ الْقَوْمَ الظَّالِمِينَ. And protect me from all the oppressors. Allahu Akbar. Now see, Asiya bint Muzahim, she asked Allah three things in the ayah. رَبِّ ابْنِي لِي عِنْدَكَ بَيْتًا فِي الْجَنَّةِ. The first request, house in the heaven. Two, نَجْنِي مِنْ فِرْعَوْنَ. Keep me away, rescue me from Fir'aun. Three, وَنَجْنِي مِنَ الْقَوْمَ الظَّالِمِينَ. Ya Allah, rescue me from all the oppressors. Right? That is Asiya. But one thing you have to imagine. All the three requests of Asiya was for who? For herself. True or false? Because I asked, Najni, right? Ibn Li, Ya Allah, beg for me. Every dua is for her. Now come to Zahra alayhi salam. Up to here, we're talking about Asia.
I was with my mother Zahra in the house all my life. He said, I never heard her to make dua for herself.
Imam Hassan said, all her life she never made dua.
رب ارزقني رب اعطني.
There is no such dua in Zahra alayhi salam. What did she used to make dua?
What was her dua?
Imam Hassan said, كان تدعو لأمة محمد. الله الله
محمد. She used to make dua for whom? For the entire ummah of Ali Muqtafar. Of her father, and then also to Shia to Ahl al-Bayt alayhi wa salam, and every person, every neighbor,
that is the people that she makes dua. Imam Hassan said, it got to the point I was wondering, I went to her.
I asked her, Ya Ummah, ma li la tad'ayna li nafsik? Why is it that every time, Salat al-Layl, Dhuhr, Asr, I see you making dua,
but never mention anything for yourself. You know what she said, Zahra alayhi wa salam? She says, بني الحسن الجار ثم الدار. We Ahl al-Bayt alayhum as-salam, we always concern about neighbors more than we concern about our own selves. Now you look at Zahra alayhi as-salam and you look at Asiya, they both are great people, chosen women in Islam, in the Quran. But one is better than the other. And between these two, who is better than the other? Az-Zahra alayhi salam.
Because she always put others first before herself. And Quran talks about them. وَيُؤْثِرُونَ عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِهِمْ وَلَوْ كَانَ بِهِمْ خَصَاصًا.
They put others first, even if they also are in need of that.
That is Zahra alayhi salam. So one of the lessons that we can learn from Zahra alayhi salam is that she always put others first
before herself. And that is one of the highest Islamic qualities, Islamic characters. That is one about Zahra.
Zahra alayhi salam, she has reached a level, brothers and sisters, that the angels didn't even reach to that level.
You know, we read in Laylat al-Isra al-Mi'raj, that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wa sallam is above Jibreel,
but not just the Prophet, even Zahra alayhi salam, she is better than the Jibreel as well.
And maybe somebody will ask, what is the proof? I said, give you the proof. You read Hadith al-Kisa, don't you? Read it carefully.
Zahra alayhi salam, in Hadith al-Kisa, she said, when the Prophet walks into her house,
and she said, and the Prophet said to her, إِتِينِي بِالْكِسَاءِ الْيَمَانِي فَغَطِّينِي بِهِ. Bring me the cloak made from Yemen and cover me with that. And she did. Right? Now listen to Zahra alayhi salam.
After she did, what did she say?
She said, فَصِرْتُ أَنْظُرُ إِلَيْهِ. He said, then I continue to be looking at the face of Rasulullah. Now you and I, when you cover something with the blanket, can you see it after you cover it?
Find a blanket and cover something. Can you see it?
No, you cannot.
But Zahra said, I cover Rasulullah, but I still could see the face of the Prophet. Not all just the face. I can see the noor. فَإِذَا بِوَجْهِهِ يَتَلَأْلَأُ كَأَنَّهُ الْبَدْرُ فِي لَيْلَةِ تَمَامِهِ وَكَمَانِهِ.
That
is Zahra alayhi salam, right? That is the first one. Now, not only that. Now, did Zahra, she covered Rasulullah, but the noor, she still could see that, right? Now, go to Jibreel. After Allah said to the Prophet, to the angels,
Ya malaikati wa ya sukana samawati inni ma khalaqtu sama'an mabniyan wala ardan madhiyan ولا بحرا يجري ولا فلكا يسري الا لاجل ما الا لاجلكم ومحبتكم.
Right
now listen, Jibreel, what did he say to Allah? يا ربي ومن هم تحت الكساء.
Asking Allah, يا رب, who are those under the blanket? Meaning Jibreel could not see who are under the blanket. But Zahra alayhi salam, after she covered Rasulullah, the noor of the Prophet could be seen by her, and she made that statement.
But Jibreel said, He said, Ya Rabb, وَمَنْ هُمْ تَحْتَ الْكِسْرَى. Who are under the blanket? That is to let us understand what Zahra could see, Jibreel cannot see. That is Zahra alayhi salam. That is one. Number two in the same hadith al-Kisa. When Jibreel asked Allah, وَمَنْ هُمْ تَحْتَ الْكِسْرَى. Look at the answer of Allah. Ya Rabb, مَنْ هُمْ تَحْتَ الْكِسْرَى. Allah said, هُمْ Rasulullah? هُمْ Ali? هُمْ الْحَسَنِ? No. The first one Allah mentioned, even though Rasulullah was there, even though Imam Ali was there, he said, هُمْ فَاطِمَا وَأَبُوهَا وَبَعْلُهَا وَبْنُهَا. The first one Allah mentioned is Zahra alayhi salam. Despite the fact that Rasulullah was there, but the first one Allah mentioned is to show us the importance of Zahra alayhi salam. That is in Hadith al-Kisa. Not only that, brothers and sisters. You know Zahra alayhi salam, when you go to the tafsir Nur al-Thaqalain, he mentioned this ayah. He said, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, مرج البحرين يلتقيان. مرج البحرين, two oceans were to meet at one point. In that tafsir, you know, we have two kinds of tafsir. Tafsir al-zahir and tafsir al-batin. Al-tafsir al-zahir is that the apparent tafsir. Al-bahr in Arabic is a sea. But no, when you come to tafsir al-bayt, they say, no, that is not the sea as you and I know. No. They say that Bahrul Imama wa Bahrul Risala. The two oceans. The ocean of Imama and the ocean of Risala. The ocean of Risala started from where? From Adam alayhi salam. And now it's ending with Rasulullah. And it has to take a turn from the Risala to the Imama. But it needs at the meeting point between the Risala and Imama. Who is that being who can merge these two together other than Zahra alayhi salam? There was no man or a woman in the earth who can mix those two oceans together except Zahra alayhi salam. She is the daughter of the Prophet. She has the blood of Risala and she is the mother of the Imams, where she can also take that Risala and turn it in her and then pass the Imama to the Imams. And that is why when Allah says, مرج البحرين يلتقيان أي يلتقيان في الزهراء عليه السلام. That is زهراء عليه السلام. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about how she, this woman, is so great. Not only that, you come to the Quran and the ayat al-mubahala, when Allah sent this ayah, فَمَنْ حَجَّكَ فِيهِ مِنْ بَعْدِ مَا جَاءَكَ مِنَ الْعِلْمِ فَقُلْ تَعَالَوْ نَتْعُ أَبْنَاءَنَا وَأَبْنَاءَكُمْ وَنِسَاءَنَا وَنِسَاءَكُمْ. Allah, check all the tafsirs. No exception. Every mufassir that you can find, tafsir al-Zamakhshari, tafsir al-Kabir, Fakhr al-Razi, Tafsir al-Suyuti, every tafsir that you can find, pick it up, look at this ayah. What did they say? That on the day of Mubahala, when the Prophet Allah told them, Ya Rasulullah, bring four individuals. One is yourself, one is your children, one is your men and your women. Bring all of them. Allah, check all the tafsir. They say, when the Prophet came to choose himself, who did he choose? Amir al-Mu'mineen, Imam Ali alayhi salam. No one tafsir said that a prophet chose somebody other than Imam Ali. Which means Imam Ali alayhi salam is nafsun nabi. No question. Because the ayah says, wa anfusana, ourselves, and he chose Imam Ali alayhi salam. Then he come to Nisa'ana. Nisa'ana, our women. The prophet was married. He has women. But not even single of his wife was called into this. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam brought Zahra alayhi wasallam. The children, there are so many children in Medina, but the Prophet didn't bring anybody other than Al-Hasan and Hussein. Right? And that is not even the point. The point is, look at on the day of Mubahala, how the Prophet brought them out. The Prophet was the leader. And he was carrying Imam Hussein. And Imam Hassan was on the right side. And behind the Prophet is whom? Zahra alayhi salam.
Then behind Zahra is Imam Ali alayhi salam, which is exactly the ayah we just mentioned, that me, the Prophet, is the leader. That is the Bahar al-Risala, and Zahra is the meeting point, and the behind Zahra is Imam Ali, which is the Imam and the Risala, they have to meet together, and the meeting point is Zahra alayhi salam.
And that is
how the Prophet brought them out. Huh?
Look at all the tafsir. No one tafsir said the Prophet brought one person, not the other person. And because of this ayah, this particular ayah al-Mubahala, when they asked one of the great scholars of the Muslims, Imam Hanbal, when they asked him, they said, "Man hum ashabul Nabi? Who are the companions of the Prophet?" They said, "The first companion that I know of is Abu Bakr." "Then who?" He said, "Then Umar." "Then whom?" He said, "Then Uthman." "Then whom?" He said, "That's it. There are three companions that I know of." Then they ask him, "وَأَيْنَ خَلَّيْتَ عَلِيًّا?" "Where did you leave Ali? He's not a companion." Now listen to his answer. He says, "سَأَلْتُمُونِي أَنْ أَصْحَابِ النَّبِي." "You ask me about the companions of the Prophet. وَلَمْ تَسْأَلُونِي أَنْ نَفْسِ النَّبِيِّ فَإِنَّ عَلِيَّ نَفْسُ
النَّبِيِّ."
That is his words.
He said, if you'll ask me, who is the nafs al nabi, I'll tell you, Ali is the nafs al nabi. Why? Because of this ayah. وَأَنْفُسَنَا وَأَنْفُسَكُمْ. But you ask me about the companion, and I give you those companions. But Imam Ali is not a companion, it's Nafsul Nabi. Because of this ayah. But Zahra alayhi salam, she was the woman that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made her to be between the two oceans.
And this woman, Zahra alayhi salam, when you come to her life, she was the one who was the most giving to everybody that you could ever find. Any person who wants something, the house of Zahra is place to go. And that's the sunnah of the Prophet. The Prophet told us up to now, if any person wants something from Ahli, from Allah, Zahra's house is the door to go. And the reason is Hadith al-Kisa. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he was feeling weak, inni ashuru fi badani du'fa, where did he go? There is Masjid al-Nabawi, the house of Allah. But he didn't go there, right? Where did he go? He went to the house of Zahra and he gave his complaint to Zahra. "Ya Fatima, inni ashuru fi badani du'fa." I feel weakness in my body. "Ya Rasulullah, why me?" Because if the Prophet does something, it becomes sunnah for all Muslims to follow that sunnah. If the Prophet goes to the house of Zahra and told her have this problem, that means every Muslim is supposed to follow that path. It becomes sunnah. Because the Prophet knew that nobody goes to the house of Zahra and ask, and the Prophet or Ahlul Bayt say no to them. No. It's impossible. That is Zahra alayhi salam. And her house, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, every time he comes and he knocks the door, the house of Zahra, and Zahra opens the door, and she says, "Ya Rasulullah, tafadhal, al-baytu baytuk, wal-karimatu karimatuk." "Ya Rasulullah, the house is your house and the daughter is your daughter. Why do you need to knock the door? Why do you need to ask salam?" You know what the Prophet said to her? "Ya Zahra, inna Allah amarani bina." Allah ordered me to say salam before entering your house. You know, this is for the people who think Zahra and the Prophet, their relationship is about because a daughter and the father. No. It's more than that. Allah is telling the Prophet, "Ya Rasulullah, this is how you should treat Zahra alayhi salam." It's beyond that. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in the Quran, وَلَسَوْفَ يُعْطِيكَ رَبُّكَ فَتَرْضَى. Right? Allah said to the Prophet, we will give you, Ya Rasulullah, something that you will be pleased. Now look at the Quran. What did Allah give to the Prophet to make him please? Allah said in Surah Al-Kawthar, "Inna a'tainaka al-kawthar." The ayah, listen carefully to the surah, right? "Wala sawfa yu'tik."
Allah said, we will give you, right? When? Allah didn't mention. But then he comes to another ayah. He said, أَعْطَيْنَاكْ We gave you al-kawthar. And kawthar is Zahra alayhi salam. There Allah said, we gave you to make you to be pleased, Ya Rasulullah. That is Zahra alayhi salam. Zahra alayhi salam, when the Prophet sees her, she's walking towards him. كان رسول الله يقوم إجلالا لها. The Prophet always turns for respect for Zahra alayhi salam. Allah, do you know what this means, brothers and sisters? You know, every ma'soom, every prophet, right? Whatever he does, the entire universe, they go according to that prophet. When the prophet says the dhikr, even the animals, they're supposed to say the same thing after that prophet. And this is from the Quran. Allah tells about Prophet Dawood alayhi salam, Ya jibalu awwibi ma'ahu wa tayr. Allah told the mountains and the birds. I said, oh, you mountains and you the birds. I said, when you're doing tasbih, make sure that your tasbih matches the tasbih of my ma'soom, which is Dawood at that time. If that Allah tells those animals and even the nature to listen to the ma'soom of their time, that means Allah would have told the entire universe to do the same thing to the Prophet. Now, if the Prophet stands, the entire universe stands. For whom? For Zahra alayhi salam. Zahra alayhi salam, one of the examples we can learn from her. Zahra, when she gives the best of what she has. You know, some of us, we also give, right? Sometimes we have clothes that we give, shoes that we give. But what do we give? Clothes that we don't want, the older ones, right? We give it to those donation companies. But the good ones, what do? That stays in the closet. That's for us. That's us, right? But you know, Zahra is opposite. Zahra alayhi salam, when she gives, she doesn't give the worst of what she has. She gives the best of what she has. And that is when the Prophet came to her one day. He said, Ya Zahra, I don't see you wearing your wedding gown that we bought for you, expensive one. She said, no, Ya Rasulullah, I give it away. Why, Ya Zahra? This is for you. She said, no, I know it's for me. But I heard Allah said in the Quran, لَن تَنَالُوا الْبِرَّ حَتَّى تُنْفِقُوا مِمَّا تُحِبُّونَ. You're not gonna get good from Allah unless you give the best of what you have. He said, Ya Rasulullah, I look in my clothes. The best of what I have was that one. And I wanted to give it away so I can get the best from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allahu Akbar. That is Zahra alayhi salam. Zahra alayhi salam, she was the woman who was able to feel in the life of the Prophet the motherhood that the Prophet was missing. To the point she was named Ummu. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, as you know, he never had the mother in his life. He was very young when the mother passed away. Then Fatima bint Asad was taking care of him. Then she passed. He never had any woman to take care of that motherhood in his life. Zahra alayhi salam, she was the one who filled that. Zahra alayhi salam, with all these qualities, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam talks about her, Fatima tu bada'atun min. Man ahabbaha faqad ahabba. Wa man abghadaha faqad abghada. In some narration, Fatima tu bada'atun minni. Man aadhaha faqad aadhani. Wa man aadhani faqad aadallah. The Prophet is saying, Fatima is part of me. Whoever hurts her, hurts me. And he said in Hadith al-Kisa, Allahumma ha'ulai ahlu bayti wa khasati wa hammati lahmuhum lahmu wa damuhum damu yu'limuni ma ya'limu yahzununi ma yahzunu ana salmun liman salamu wa harbun liman harbun. The Prophet says,
لحمهم, this flesh is my flesh.
Their skin is my skin. Everything that hurts them hits me.
That is how much the Prophet was emphasizing. You know, the night of the Shahada of the Prophet or the death of the Prophet, Ahlul Bayt was sitting around the Prophet. Zahra was sitting next to the feet of her father, looking at her father, Rasulullah. The Prophet was crying, and she was crying. Imam Ali was crying. Al-Hassan and Hussein, they were by the feet of the Prophet. They were crying. Then the Prophet invited Zahra. Ya Zahra, taqarrabi. Come closer to me. She came closer. Then the Prophet said something in her ears. She went back crying. The Prophet was crying too.
Then after a few minutes, the Prophet called her again, Ya Zahra, come. She came.
And the Prophet said something in her ear. Then what happened? Then she started laughing again. Ya Zahra, a minute ago you were crying, and now you're smiling. What's the matter? Now she's responding. She said, the first call the Prophet called me, he told me about his death tonight. And I cry because he's the dearest one to me. Allahu Akbar. What about the second one, Ya Zahra? She says, the Prophet told me, Ya Zahra, anti sari'atil lihaqbi. You are the first one to meet me in Barzakh. The first person to die in my Ahlul Bayt is you, Zahra. Ya Zahra, how old are you? 18 years old. Allahu Akbar. Zahra alayhi salam, she cried for losing such a person at the Prophet in her life. Immediately after the Prophet passed, they came to a house. The house that the Prophet was told by Allah, don't enter the house unless you say salam. Don't enter that house unless the permission came to you to come in. And the Prophet always asked permission. That house was attacked. Zahra alayhi salam, she was in the house. The narration says she was behind the door when they attacked the house. They pushed the door and there was a nail inside that door. The nail came straight to the back of Zahra alayhi salam. The first thing that the nail did was to break that backbone of Zahra alayhi salam. Not only that, also to cause that baby she was carrying, which the Prophet already named him Mahsin, caused that baby to be lost. Zahra alayhi salam was standing there after this incident. She called, Ya Asma Asnidini. Ya Asma, please come to my rescue. I can't stand anymore. I need your help to stand. Zahra alayhi salam was helped. Allahu Akbar, my father died yesterday, and today this is how I'm being treated. My father is Rasulullah, and that is why in your khutbah she made it clear and said, listen and to remember. And said, وَكُنْتُمْ تَكْتَادُونَ الطَّرَقِ فَأَنْقَذَكُمْ اللَّهُ بِأَبِي مُحَمَّدِ. He said, you used to drink alcohol. Remember your life before Islam, and my father came and rescued you. And today that is his reward that you're going to pay him. To kill his daughter, 18 years old. The narration said, Zahra alayhi salam, she could not stand. And Asma alayhi salam, she was the one who held her, brought her to the inside for her to sit down. The narration said, they attacked that house of Zahra alayhi salam, and not only they attacked the house, they burned some part of the house. Allahu Akbar. The house of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The narration said, Zahra alayhi salam, the next day the women of Medina, they came to visit her, and she was telling them, Kayfa, they asked Zahra, Kayfa asbahti? How are you doing, Zahra? Zahra said, Wallahi asbahtu ghadibatun min rijalikun. I'm angry about your men. who attacked my house, broke my back, and caused me to lose my son. Allahu Akbar. وَيَا أَمِيرَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ وَعَفِّي مَوْضَعَ قَبْرِي. Today that is the one of the shame on the face of Muslims in the world, that Rasulullah left one daughter in this life, and today the Muslims don't even know where the grave of that daughter is. Allahu Akbar. The only daughter the Prophet had. And today we cannot locate where she was buried. You know, the Jews, the Christians, Prophet Isa alayhi salam was riding a horse or a camel, and they saw a footprint of that camel. They took that place to become a place of worship. They built a church in that place. You think in honor with the footprint of Isa alayhi salam, not his footprint, no, the camel he was riding. And this is Zahra alayhi salam. The print of the Prophet himself, which he says, Fatima tu bada'atun minni, is part of me. But that is how we treated Zahra alayhi salam. Now what happened with Zahra alayhi salam? The narration says, on the day of her shahada, as normal, she always wakes up in the morning and does everything she's supposed to do, even though she is the best woman in Islam, but she does her responsibility as a wife in the house. And she told Imam Ali alayhi salam before his shahada, I said, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, هل عصيتك طرفة عين أبدا. Have I ever disobeyed you in anything in our life together? Imam Ali alayhi salam said, La, Ya Zahra, I never seen you disobeyed me in anything. Allahu Akbar. Then she said to Imam Ali alayhi salam, some of the things that she was, she said, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, إذا منت ودفني, I want you to bury me. وقرأ لي سورة ياسين والصفا. I want you to read Surah Yasin and Safat for me every night. And Imam Ali alayhi salam was doing that. Until one night Imam Ali went there. At a grave, at night, when everybody asleep, he was reading Surah Yasin and Safat. And he fell asleep for a few seconds. And he saw Zahra alayhi salam. Zahra came to him and she said to her, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, from tonight I don't want you to come to my grave to read Surah Yasin and Safat. Imam Ali asked, that was your wish that you asked for? She said, yes, I know I asked for it. But you can read this surah, two surahs at home. Imam Ali asked her, why? She said, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, after you left and came here, Al-Hasan wal-Husayn, they woke up in the middle of night. And they look at my bed, I'm not there. And they look at the place, you are not there. And I saw them, they had broken hearted because their father and the mother both are not there for them. And she said, I don't want this to happen for them anymore. From that moment, I said, Imam Ali alayhi salam, I said, I lifted the responsibility. You can read these two surahs for me at home. Zahra alayhi salam, on the day of her shahada, the narration said, she made Imam Hassan and Hussein got ready after they had their breakfast and they left. And she said to Asma, I'm going to read Quran. And as I read the Quran, if you never heard my voice again, that means I departed from this world. Allahu Akbar. Look at the sign of Zahra alayhi salam. The sign of her death is the recitation of Quran. Asma said, I was in the house, but I was listening to her, listening to the Quran of Zahra alayhi salam, and as she continued reading the Quran, she said, I heard the voice was fading slowly and slowly, and the voice was becoming thinner and thinner. You see, until the moment came, I couldn't hear anything from Zahra alayhi salam, and I knew from what she said, maybe she has departed from this world. Zasma said, I rushed to her, and as soon as I got to the place to see her, I saw her, she was laying down. She said, I was watching, what should I do? Then suddenly Al-Hasan and Hussein went to the room. She said, as I was standing, Imam Hussein asked me, she says, Aina Ummul Zahra, where is our mother? She said, I didn't know what to say to her, to him. Should I say she's dead or should I say she's out? She said, then I decided to tell them she is sleeping. Then Hussein alayhi salam said, you know that this is not the time our mother normally sleeps. Tell me, where is our mother Zahra alayhi salam? Asma said, I stood up looking, I didn't know what to do. Then I finally showed them, this is your mother Zahra alayhi salam. She said, as soon as I pointed to them, Imam Hussein dropped himself on the body of Zahra alayhi salam, and the same as Hassan alayhi salam. And Imam Hussein was saying, Ya Ummi, kallimini qabla an yakhruj badani ruhi min badani. She was telling her mother, oh my mother, please speak to me before my spirit depart from my body. And she said this three times. Asma said, I was standing there watching the whole incident. She said, wallahi, I saw like Zahra alayhi salam. She was pulling her hand to hug Hussein alayhi salam and Hassan. Even at that moment, Allahu Akbar, Zahra alayhi salam. That born with their children, Al-Hassan and Hussein. The narration said, they are in that situation. Then the narration got to Imam Ali alayhi salam. He walked in and he saw the scene that Zahra alayhi salam, she has left this world. And this is Hassan and Hussein. They are laying on their body, trying to get the mother to talk to them. The narration said that Imam Ali alayhi salam took Imam Hassan and Hussein on the Zahra alayhi salam. The narration said Imam Ali alayhi salam started the ghusl of Zahra alayhi salam. He and Asma, they were washing the body. Imam Ali said, wallahi kullama aradtu janibanna. Every time I went to one part, that part turns over for me without even moving anything. Allahu Akbar. Imam Ali alayhi salam, as he was washing, the Asma said, I saw suddenly Imam Ali turn towards the wall and screamed. I asked him, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, why they scream? She said, wallahi, I saw where that nail went into her body. They said, wallahi, I saw where the backbone was broken. I saw it. Imam Ali alayhi salam stood there and cried for so long. The narration stated that after the ghusl and everything, Imam Ali alayhi salam waited until the night, as she said, and he took her with her two children to go and bury Fatima alayhi salam. And he made sure that the grave is hidden from anybody. The narration said, as he took her to the grave, as he was placing her in the grave, he said, Ya Rasulullah, wadi'atun ruddat. Amanatun ruddat, this is the trust that you gave me. And now I'm returning that trust to you, Ya Rasulullah. But the question is, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, when that trust was given, it was not broken bone. But now that trust was returned to Rasulullah, back to him, but with the broken bone. What happened, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen? Imam Ali alayhi salam put her with his wife in that grave. And he was crying. Al-Hassan and Hussein were all crying. Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. Wa sayalamu alladhina zalamu ayya munqalabin yanqalibun. Wal 'aqibatu lil muttaqin. Ya Hussein.
Ya Hussein.
Ya Hussein.
Ya Hussein.
Ya Hussein.